So we will be welcoming Josef Vortag, okay, who is a professor at the Center for Quantum Science at the University of Tübingen, okay, since 2007. So, I mean, his expertise in the area of cold atom and solid state interfaces, atoms, quantum gases, supertatomic qubits, and nanomechanical systems is part of the toolbox of his research, group. So, without further ado, let me welcome him. And the title of his talk is Ultra Cold Atoms on Superconducting Chips. Please, Josef, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much. And I would like to thank the organizers for this very kind invitation to this conference that I like very much. I enjoy always the discussion, and I'm very happy to see you all around. So today, I would like to share with you some results on cold atoms and superconducting chips that we do with this small project team. Two PhD students, Manuel and Connie, are interfering with three supervisors, David Petrosian, Andreas Günther, and myself. But being late now in the conference, I feel that it's time for a short excursion. So maybe I take you for a minute into the future. Yeah, just imagine that quantum technologies find their way into our world. So let's see, quantum computers optimize economical and logistical tasks. Quantum simulators assist the design and synthesis of new materials, and quantum sensors deliver signals from early warning systems. And all those are connected to a quantum network that actually decision-making. Now, the quantum computers, simulators and sensors are built on very different platforms. We discussed already superconducting circuits these days, ions, atoms, color centers. While the communication channels make use of optical photons. Now, color centers and atomic systems may be directly integrated into such a network by emitting quantum light directly into the infrared telecom band. But superconducting circuits seem to be more challenging to integrate into the system since they operate with microwave photons. Now, a bridge could be formed by atoms that interact with both microwaves and optical photons. Now, superconducting circuits are usually coupled to microwave cavities that is illustrated here in the picture as a box. Here, the microwave in between is confined by the cavity that gives us a chance to transfer the quantum state to atoms. So the atoms convert the microwave to optical photons in a Raman process, and the optical photons may be guided into a fiber network via an optical cavity, which is here illustrated as a mirror between, as a cavity between a mirror and the fiber tip. So this way, superconductors may be integrated into distant networks. Now, the system is, however, very complex and challenging. Now, there are several proposals that suggest integrating superconducting circuits, qubits, cavities, atoms, and light onto a single chip, which should be in a millikelvin environment, because superconducting circuits operate with high fidelity only in millikelvin conditions. So it is there have been experiments started on this, but this is still a challenge. Now, the situation is somewhat relaxed if we use a quantum state transfer protocol that has been proposed by Peter Zolla, which tolerates noise and thermal photons in the channels that way that the atomic box containing a microwave cavity, atoms, and optical cavities is moved out from the millikelvin environment, and it could be in a few Kelvin environment. Now, let us look at some, I would say, almost classical hybrid quantum processor. The most of the processors, most of the proposals deal with that. Here we can see a superconducting qubit or a superconducting circuit in which the information is processed. The results, the quantum state is transferred to microwave cavity as a data bus. And the atoms are suggested as a good quantum memory, which can be certainly coupled to optical photons. This coupling microwave to optical can be considered in a Raman process using grid bank atoms, for example, on a superconducting chip next to the cavity. Two lasers bump the atomic system, and whenever a microwave is absorbed by the atom, it is coherently emitted here with the proper choice of laser illumination in a phase match direction, for example, into an optical fiber. And now, having grid bank atoms on a chip, we may make use of other advantages. As we all know, grid bank atoms in a microwave cavity belong to the most well-controlled quantum optical systems. Now we would have the difficulty to bring them down to a chip surface, but it is promising because cavity is mediating long distance interactions between grid bank atoms, strongly interacting with the cavity. And it is different to next neighbor interaction that is mostly used in gate operations. So it is an all-to-all interaction. Each atom placed into an antinode of the cavity will interact with all the other at the same time. I would like to highlight some proposals that the system is working not only in millikelvin environment, but tolerates also thermal photons in the microwave cavity. A Sorensen-Mölmer gate has been proposed by my colleague David Petrosian that is possible even at a few Kelvin temperature, or a swap gate that is possible if a cavity mode is cooled. Now, all these is, I believe, enough motivation to go into the lab and look at the interaction between cold atoms and superconducting circuits, cold ground state atoms or cold grid bank atoms, and couple them to an integrated cavity. Now, the experiments we do in a 4-Kelvin system that is illustrated here, a vacuum chamber that combines a cold atom setup with a helium flow cryostat is the system that I will discuss today. We do operate also a millikelvin system in which we can cool chips down to a few tens of millikelvin temperature, and we transport atoms towards the surface. My colleague Rainer Dunke also operates a system in Singapore like this that he reported about this week. Here the lab, the vacuum chamber with the cold atom setup and the cryostat. And if we look into this vacuum chamber with this camera, then we see the following. Below the magneto-optical trap with in vacuum electromagnets, the atoms are trapped magnetically, transported to a strongly confining trap, cooled down to a few microkelvin. We pick up the atoms by an optical tweezer and transport them to the surface of a superconducting chip that contains wire components for trapping and microwave cavities. We use rubidium atoms for these experiments. We trap rubidium in both of its hyperfine state, yeah, and which has a splitting of 6.8 gigahertz, which will be important now for the experiment. So we can make superposition between two magnetically trapped state. And we use harmonic confinement with thermal atomic clouds and Bose-Einstein condensates. Let us look at some experiments. The magnetic trap in the experiment is formed here by a Z-shaped wire with a bias field that is coming aside. This is forming the harmonic trap, and the atoms can be moved to a microwave cavity to look at all these experiments. But maybe you excuse me, I'm also an experimentalist, and we experimentalists like to play in the lab and like straightforward, nice experiments very much, and therefore I show you a tiny object on this chip, which is a superconducting ring of 10 micron radius, in which we can trap flux quanta. If we do so and bring an atomic Bose-Einstein condensate above this superconducting ring, then we expect to see a change in the magnetic trapping potential. Now let's look at that. So the superconducting ring carries a persistent current, and the flux in the ring is quantized, one flux quanta, two or more. This magnetic field is superposed to the magnetic field of the trap, making the trap at one side stronger, at the other weaker. Essentially, we receive a potential which has a kind of double well shape. And if we look at that, at this left-hand side, the trap is very shallow, it's leaky. What we observe at the end, if we load atoms into this trap, then we see that depending on the number of flux quanta in this ring, the trap is more or less lossy. So the magnetic field changes stepwise with the magnetic flux, and the number of trapped atoms is changing stepwise with the magnetic flux. So this small experiment on observing flux quantization is very nice to do in the lab. And after this intermediate success, we can turn to microwave cavities, which will be a more tough subject. But here we can also use our observation that in a superconducting ring, a persistent current can modify the trapping potential. Actually, here the microwave cavity is formed as a closed superconducting loop, and we can form a persistent trap around this close to the microwave cavity. Now, the atomic cloud has a long lifetime of minutes in this cryogenic environment. We can observe the coherence of superposition states of the hyperfine ground state in a Ramsey type experiment, which is holding also for several seconds. Now, having established the experimental system of rubidium atoms on a chip, long coherence, and I didn't detail, we can make noise protected memory states by microwave tracing. The question, the main question, is the atom cavity coupling. The fabricated cavity is made of niobium on sapphire substrate, has a fundamental frequency of 6.8 gigahertz, matching exactly the rubidium hyperfine splitting, and the Q factor is around 10,000 at 4 Kelvin. In this presentation, I will use not only the fundamental mode, but also the third harmonics of the cavity, which has a slightly worse quality factor. The trap or the chip has the integrity trap, but this I've shown. Now, what about the cavity resonance? This is a little characterization how the cavity resonance is shifting with temperature, how the Q factor is changing. Essentially, the temperature range in which we can reasonably use the cavity is between 4 and 6 Kelvin. And in this range, we can tune the cavity resonance by about 30 megahertz, not too much, but it helps in such an experiment. So the cavity resonance measures the hyperfine splitting of rubidium at 6 Kelvin. Let us see the magnetic coupling. We drive the cavity with a strong microwave, 10 to the 9 photons. And depending on the time when the cavity drive is turned on, we observe a change between the two hyperfine states, Fe1 and Fe2. Yeah. I noticed that in this experiment, we see a very strong dephasing. We do see a Rabi oscillation, but it's difficult to say the coherence time. It is easy to say the dephasing time. Yeah. And we may wonder that this comes from the fact that one of the hyperfine states is trapped and the microwave is pumping the atoms into a state which is non-trapped. Therefore, we could make another experiment using the state next to it, which is equally trapped, like the F equal one, minus one, the F equal two, plus one state. For this, we need an additional radio frequency to add to the cavity field. This is not in the cavity, we just radiated from an external source. And here we also see the same fast dephasing. Yeah. Interesting is that the dephasing here to, at the left-hand side, the Rabi frequency is about 20 kilohertz. The dephasing is exactly on the time scale of a Rabi oscillation. If you go to the two-photon resonance, which has a factor of 100 less Rabi frequency here, notice the time scale change. Yeah? It is dephasing exactly on a couple of oscillation periods. So the answer, why is that? It turns out that the inhomogeneity of the driving field next to the cavity is large across the atomic cloud. So atoms closer to the chip surface experience a stronger field from the cavity, atoms further away, a weaker, which is leading always to this dephasing on the time scale of few Rabi cycles. Now, if we go now, we could continue on that. We could improve that certainly by dressing states, making differential shifts smaller, selecting small sheets from the atomic cloud, but the magnetic coupling is rather weak, and therefore we decided in our course to change to Rydberg atoms, which promise at least 100 or 1000 or even stronger coupling on the single atom level than the magnetic coupling, even if we account for collective enhancement. But I would like to say that I do see a chance to make a coupling with collective magnetic coupling with collective enhancement. This study should be done at some point. Now, the Rydberg atoms close to the chip are prepared by a pair of lasers that excite the rubidium ground state to some Rydberg state. Here, the Rydberg state R1 is relevant for us, and R2, because those two will be coupled by the microwave. I notice here a state Rx, yeah, which are optically excited, but do not couple to the microwave cavity. Therefore, we call that X, and we drop it for from our consideration of the coupling. Below the chip, there is an extraction electrode, and below that, a channel electron multiplier. With this extraction electrode, we can apply strong electric fields for field ionizing Rydberg atoms, and with the channel electron multiplier, we can count single ions. So the atoms are again trapped close to the cavity, now in an antinode of the electric field, and the cavity is driven at the third harmonics, which is around 20.5 gigahertz, to match some Rydberg states. This is a very clear, clean scheme. The difficulty comes into the system with a surface, which is collecting rubidium atoms on course of the experiment, and adsorbed rubidium atoms are polarized on the surface and provide strong inhomogeneous field. So the big task will be selection of Rydberg state to match the cavity resonance and suppress differential shifts between the pair of Rydberg states. How large is the field in our experiment? For this, please consider this diagram here. The chip surface here, the extraction electrode is here. Essentially, I turned this scheme by 90 degrees. And then here I observe that the measure in the experiment, the data is here not shown, that the electric field decays exponentially from the surface, and where our atomic cloud is, the atomic cloud is this big red Gaussian. We have around 10 volts per centimeter electric field. Because of the extraction electrodes, we can apply an electric field in the Z direction. This is the compensation field. So we can set the Z component of the electric field at some point to zero. But in this setup, we do not have compensation for X and Y. So we do have the remaining field at the atoms. And this is around 3.5 volts per centimeter. Now, we place the atom cloud in a way that some of the Rydberg states, exactly the R1, which is interesting for us, is excited in the center of the cloud. If you look at the Rydberg stark map, the Rydberg manifold, we can see that's the state R1, which is the 48D readback state, should have at the given electric field a resonant somewhere in the 47 manifold with angular momentum L larger than 3. So here we search the second state. And that, let's look at the differential shift. This is interesting. So now look at the differential shift of those two states, which is illustrated here. This is showing the readback lines and the transition probability to the readback line. So together with the cavity resonance frequency. So ideally, we would say that we pick here one resonance which coincides with the cavity resonance and has a strong, it's a strong transition that we can excite the atom efficiently. We can transfer the readback state, one readback state to the other efficiently. Unfortunately, it turns out that this area left, this shaded area to the left below 3.5 volts per centimeter is not accessible in our experiment because we cannot compensate this field. So we move to the right. To the right, we see wonderful strong lines, yeah, that we would like to reach, but unfortunately the cavity tuning with 30 megahertz doesn't reach those lines. So essentially, sometimes you are lucky, sometimes not. I would say here we are still lucky. We find a wonderful resonance, is not the strongest, but there is a resonance that we can attempt to use to drive readback transitions by the cavity. And that's what we do. We do apply the optical excitation pulse. We do apply a microwave pulse. And afterwards, we ramp up the electric field on this extraction electrode to field ionize the readback atoms. Essentially, on average, we excite on the order of one readback atom in this system. And that's what we observe now. This is a signal of the state selective field ionization. The 48D, the starting state, is arriving at our detector earlier than the 47, the target state. So if the microwave is off, then we mainly observe the, or we only observe the 48D state. But as you can see, the boundary is a matter of definition. So the 48D state ionizes also later. So there is some overlap. But when we turn on the microwave, then we observe the 47 state, which is driven by the cavity from 48 to 47. Now we vary the microwave pulse and observe the oscillation between the two readback states. So this Rabi oscillation can be observed for different microwave powers. And again, what we observe is a dephasing on the time scale of the excitation. So on the time scale of the Rabi frequency. And the question again, why is that? So we have an atomic cloud, which is just in the magnetic coupling experiment, has a Gaussian profile and is large. However, the optical excitation sheet and the microwave excitation sheet is rather thin, a couple of microns, because exactly the adsorbate fields from the surface causes stark detuning that only this shell will be resonant with both fields. Nonetheless, if we look at carefully the system, it turns out, if you look, if you watch carefully, the electric field from the cavity, the field of the radiation, is not coinciding, the geometry is not coinciding with this sheet. So essentially, from here, the green to the blue, so the electric field is changing within this sheet, and we arrive with the same problem that within the excitation sheet in which we measure the Rabi oscillation, we have different Rabi frequencies at different positions, which leads to dephasing. Now, we made the first steps. Yeah, we established coupling of trapped atoms to superconducting microwave cavities, but there is still a long way to go to reach strong coupling between atoms and the microwave cavity, which is desired for all the quantum state transfer schemes. And at this point, we decided to look at the atomic system again very carefully. Rydberg atoms with their strong coupling are promising in this system, and we decided to look at the Rydberg gas with a microscope. And to look at this Rydberg gas with a microscope in strong fields. So we developed a setup in which we have extractor electrodes here in between the Mott and Rydberg excitation, and some electrostatic lenses are imaging the position and the time of the Rydberg excitation in the atomic cloud. We have a microscope with a magnification about 1,000, so we can observe where and when Rydberg atoms are excited here. Now, what we can do, first of all, we can, with a few tens of minutes, detect a full stark map of a Rydberg state, which helps us to experimentally study some Rydberg state, which is interesting on the superconducting experiment. We see the variation of the energy, we see the strength of the lines, and we can compare our measurement data with the theoretical calculations. And we can go to very high fields. The classical ionization limit is roughly here. Even above the classical ionization limit, we do see very sharp resonances. Yeah. And I always admired by the theory, which is always more clean than the experiment, but we find here in this data very good match if you look at some structures on the theory and experiment, then this data is helpful to calibrate our models. So now let's look at some interesting point in the stark map in detail. So I go to the 43S state in the stark map at the high field. Yeah. The 43, we used before the 48 state, the 43 is very close to it. And we can investigate how this state can be used for the coupling to the chip. What are the features? First of all, we see the excitation probability from the ground state of these stark states. Again, I emphasize in very high fields. They are narrow lines. We are very much above the classical ionization limit. So I didn't work before with Rydberg atoms. For me, it was first surprising that they are narrow lines, but they are very narrow lines that can be excited. Now we can calculate the ionization probability of these states. What we see in gray, those are stable states. They ionize slow. The red lines illustrate fast ionizing state. And what we can see here, we can, by changing the electric field by just fractions of a volt, we can go from a very stable state to a fast ionizing. So avoided crossings adiabatically lead us from one to the other point. Back to the left, what we do see else here, we see that these dark lines are changing the slope. And we know the gradient of the stark line is the permanent electric dipole of a Rydberg atom. So there are points where the dipole moment is zero, and there are points where the dipole moment is strong. And these facts can be now used on the single atom level, for example, on the coupling to the superconducting cavity, but also on the many atom level, we could think about a nice experiment of controlling interaction dynamics. For example, if you take a Rydberg gas and excite it into a state which has a weak dipole moment, then we expect a weak dipole blockade. If we take an atom, if we excite the atom at a point in the stark map, which is very close to the previous one, separated just by half a volt, which has a strong dipole moment, then we can have a strongly interacting Rydberg gas. And what we can do, first we generate this gas, which is stable. But if you want to make a detection, we just change the electric field by a few volts and observe the signal in the ionization. An example, if we excite the atoms with strong interaction, we observe a large Rydberg blockade radius. If you change the interaction weak, then a small radius, which is immediately visible in the autocorrelation function of the position of Rydberg excited atoms. The strong dipole interaction shows a strong blockade, the weak interaction, the weak blockade. We are still at very high fields. Now, I would like to highlight on the last slide that this is now not the van der Waals interaction in the Rydberg blockade that is used in most of the experiments, but this is the dipole-dipole interaction, which is tunable long range. It decays with the power of 1 over R to the 3 instead of 1 over R to the 6, but it's tunable. And this gives us a chance of precise control of interaction dynamics of Rydberg gases in high fields. And now I would like to conclude. So I would like to conclude with the surprising result that in these chip experiments, we usually try to compensate the field of adsorbates to go to low fields in order to manipulate Rydberg atoms on the chip. Now, through the experiments with Rydberg atoms in the microscope, we see that we have very good control over Rydberg states at high electric fields. So it may be a strategy to go here on the single atom level to high fields and do the same experiments on the chip. On the other hand, from the many atom point of view, we may not only make use of the all-to-all interaction mediated by the cavity, but by the tunable next neighbor interaction at high fields. With this, I would like to thank you for your attention and looking forward to your questions.
Thank you very much, Josef, for the nice talk. Do we have questions? Yes, Luigi.
Thanks for Josef for this a very nice talk. So I have a question on the very first part of the talk when you showed this spectacular results on the magnetic field quantization of the magnetic field. So anyway, I can ask the question. So
yes, please.
What happened if you put a squid and you put it in a macroscopic swirl position? So what happened to magnetic field?
It's wonderful. I think the atoms will project the quantum state of the superposition, and you will be able to measure on the system. Now, I would like to highlight that I would love to do the experiment. For this experiment, we have to switch to the other setup in the millikelvin, where the squids hold sufficiently long coherence in order to have enough time to interact with the atoms. But this is possible. I think our colleague Rainer may be able to do it, we may be able to do it, or someone else who has a cryostat.
What do you expect? Oscillations?
Certainly, if the coupling would be strong enough, there could be oscillation. There is a theory paper by Uwe Fischer and Kerry Patton. The problem is the coupling. So essentially, we need to bring the atoms very close to this squid. And exactly, Luigi, I would expect all the dynamics of a coupled quantum system if the coupling is strong enough. From the experimental point of view, it's difficult to imagine that this strong coupling between phrase it like this: it's a challenge to make this strong coupling between a squid and the atoms. Yeah, the cavity helps in that sense. Yeah, so the cavity-mediated interactions are maybe next to reach, and mm-hmm. into the cavity, of course, you can put the squid, which is representing a qubit. You can put a different qubit, and
yeah. Maybe Quek want to ask a question.
Yes. Yes.
Right. Could you go to this slide where you were showing the start map with the ionization channels?
I go to different start maps and you say, please stop now.
Okay.
This one This one. At the end, I know the
43, yeah.
Gray and red lines, yes.
Right. Yeah. Yes, perfect. Correct me if I'm wrong, whenever you see a red line, it should not appear on the start map, on the ionization rate.
No, it's fast ionizing. So I can, I'm with you. You are right. You say if it would ionize so fast, then it would not appear on the Stark map.
Yes.
It's correct. But the ionization rate, if the ionization rate is smaller than the transition rate, then you see. But on the other hand, if you compare these stuff carefully, you may find some coincidence with this assumption. But we have to always to compare the two rates. Yeah.
Yeah, but the upper red line doesn't coincide.
Yeah,
with the start. So it's not always the case.
No, it's not always the case. But thank you very much. This is exactly a question that we have to ask at this point. Yeah, thank you.
I have a question, maybe unrelated, but you see when I see all these avoided crossings and. When I hear about the word ionization, it reminds me of these beautiful experiments done back in 1974 by Bayfield and Koch in the US, and which was one of the first evidence of quantum chaos. Because, I mean, they were shining microwave fields, okay? And you could see an ionization even though, I mean, the field was very weak, okay? And it was the first evidence of quantum chaos. So, of course, you might not be interested by this type of physics here, but still, I mean, with all this tool here, have you thought of studying quantum chaos and maybe phenomena like Anderson localization in this type of systems?
For the moment, it was not in our focus, but I'm very happy to look at this subject. So this is something that I was asking myself when we measured these dark maps. What is it telling us? What is it good for? Which physical system we can access here? And this is only the first one, what I'm showing here, that came to our mind. So.
You see, when you look at the right panel, okay, for example, on the top, the bottom left, the top left, okay, you see that there is a small avoided crossing on the left.
On the left, yeah.
No, sorry. The right panel, the white one.
Here.
Okay. Yes, exactly. Okay, when you see all these, okay, so these are, I mean, of course, you have tunnelings and so on. So I could imagine starting somewhere, and I have a lot, many kind of Zener transition, if you wish, okay? And I'm sure, I mean, you might have access to this type of physics. Of course, it can be very far away from your goal, for your scientific goal. Eh? It's just that it rings a bell in me, that's all.
I mean, I'm very happy if we can add with some explanation to a proposal. So we do operate this system, and I'm very happy about
interesting subject. I can send you a couple of reference of papers so that you see what I have in mind. But in the end, it might be very far away from what you are doing. It's just, I mean, the picture you show me are very appealing to me with my past in quantum chaos.
So thank you very much for this point here. I'm looking forward, yeah.
Okay, so then if there are no other questions, I would like to thank Joseph and all the speakers of today's session very much. Very interesting, session.